Hi, I'm Dom Portala, and you're listening to Maintaining Sweat Equity, the plight of small business in the wake of COVID. On this week's episode, I speak with John Selig, the creator of Comedy Writing for Sales Teams, a one-of-a-kind sales training course that teaches joke writing to sellers to give them an edge by creating memorable messaging for their buyers. I was recently introduced to John by the great Casey Ryan, whose own podcast, The Cutting Room Floor, is one I would highly recommend. Admittedly, sales is an industry that I know very little about. Most of my preconceived notions come directly from Glengarry Glen Ross. And what John has done by combining his sales background with a love for stand-up comedy is to find a truly unique niche that provides a strategy far more nuanced than always be closing. John and I discuss how he created Comedy Writing for Sales Teams, as well as how he was able to effectively revamp its business model. Originally, the experience would be a four-hour in-person session, usually conducted on-site for larger groups. But with COVID essentially ending all in-person conferences and events, John's approach was to refocus his already existing virtual offering while finding new ways to stand out on social media. With that said, let's hear from John.
My name is John Selig, and I'm the founder and creator of Comedy Writing for Sales Teams.
So, for anyone who's not familiar with Comedy Writing for Sales Teams, how would you describe that business?
Good question. It's half sales training and half crash course in joke writing. And I work with sales teams to help them get more relevant and memorable to their buyers. I think if we can think back to, you know, those early jokes we remember from our favorite sitcom or stand-up comedian, some of those jokes stick with us for life, and we can repeat them over and over, and we know who told it, and we know under what circumstances and why they told the joke, or what the context behind the joke was. And sales reps today, especially during this era of COVID where everyone has moved inside, you know, they're not in the office, they're not in front of customers. There's a lot of inside sales teams. Inside sales is the prevalent way that a lot of companies sell today. It's all done virtually. It's all done over the phone, through the internet. And the human connection is kind of dissipated a little bit. And a quick joke that's relevant and memorable about something the buyer struggles with, or perhaps how you can help them solve that problem, sticks with the buyer and helps build that connection, trust, and credibility for sales reps. So I teach them really how to better understand who their buyer is and their relevance to them through the process of writing jokes.
How did you discover this kind of specific niche of sales training?
I discovered that I didn't want to have a sales job any longer. And I thought this would be a great way to pursue that passion of never selling technology again, which is what I used to do. But in all seriousness, I sold technology for a dozen years or so. And I took up stand-up comedy towards the tail end of that. And right out of the gate, I saw a number of similarities between connecting with your buyer and connecting with your audience, and that a buyer is an audience. And you have to form a connection with them. You have to get them to trust you. You have to demonstrate your relevance and credibility to both the buyer and the stand-up comedy audience repeatedly. And there was just a lot of parallels, and messaging is critical to both. And I just decided to, I kind of put my hat on. I said, well, if I'm a sales rep selling plumbing supplies and I can demonstrate to my buyer some of the problems they struggle with that I can solve for them, it's a great segue to a conversation about how I could help.
You touched on it a little bit, but what do you think is the specific benefit of a salesperson understanding stand-up comedy or joke telling, or how does that tool effectively translate over to a sales rep?
A little context, there's a lot of venture-funded companies out there. They take series A, B, C, D, and you know their founders are now under pressure to scale. So they go to the head of sales and they're like, we got to do this amount of activity to get to this revenue level at this date. And that pressure, these deadlines to show the board and board of directors and the investors that they're doing everything that's asked of them so they could get to that next round of funding, that starts like a bit of a panic within the company. And I don't want to generalize, but I will, because that's what comedians do sometimes. But it's common where that the panic and the rush to demonstrate that we're doing the things you're asking us to investors, That panic and rush trickles all the way down to the sales reps. And because everyone's on these artificial deadlines to show we've had this many meetings booked, we've had this many demonstrations of our technology, we've closed this much revenue, sales reps and sales managers don't really have the time to grow into their jobs and become subject matter experts, because salespeople, especially in technology, they're not necessarily salespeople. They need to be consultants. They need to help their customers, large companies or even small companies, solve problems, solve process problems, maybe how they serve their customers, or maybe internal financial accounting problems that they're struggling with. I used to help companies with their budgeting and planning process because they were doing it all in spreadsheets. Well, guess what? We have a software that helps you eliminate spreadsheets and eliminates the need for manual work. But the problem is that a lot of the kids they're hiring, they're kind of young and out of school, and they don't really have that real world expertise. They don't really understand who the people they're calling's jobs. They understand what those people are struggling with. And the idea of writing jokes, if we look at me as a comedian, I will walk into a club and I'll see the audience is maybe all senior citizens that night, which means I can't tell them jokes about my online dating app experiences or about other experiences on social media, because maybe they're not living these experiences. So you have to be relatable. So that's number one. Number two, if I'm going to try and figure out what makes a particular audience laugh after profiling them, maybe I'm selling to chief financial officers at companies 100 million in revenue above who are in the manufacturing industry. At that point, if I'm going to be considered a solutions provider to them, I need to understand everything about their problems and their world and what their priorities are and what are the roadblocks to their success? What's in the way? And how can I help them remove one of those roadblocks or more? And it forces them, if I'm going to figure out how can I make a CFO laugh, because I want to connect with them on a human level about something that they're struggling with, I need to understand them. I need to understand everything in their world and how what I offer can help affect their world. So even if sales teams don't write great jokes, they're taking time to understand their relevance to their audience and finding a way through jokes and messaging to just be memorable and different, because a lot of messaging out there, especially with people who are just prospecting for new opportunities, sales is very segmented. There's people who are just responsible for setting up meetings, and there's another whole group of salespeople responsible for closing the business, showing them a software or understanding their problems a little bit deeper. And they just need to demonstrate that relevance really quickly. They need to stand out, but so many of them have very similar messaging. And they're all looking for growth hacks to try and get attention. And my whole philosophy is you need to stand out, you need to be different, you need to be memorable, and you need to show them you have relevance to them, usually within very short windows of time, especially if you're doing things like cold calls or cold emails.
It sounds like the strategy is kind of twofold in a way, where first you're talking about knowing your audience, which I can imagine anybody on the receiving end is going to appreciate immediately that someone's taken the time to kind of understand the perspective of whoever you're making the call to is. But then also, like you're saying, there's this finite amount of time where you've got a moment to grab them. Again, I have to imagine there might be some stigmatized concept of, with sales folks, you're talking to a robot. So the fact that you can ingratiate them with humor at the jump, knowing the audience, knowing their point of view, and being able to kind of bring them into your world with a joke or with some kind of sense of humor probably eases that process a little bit.
Absolutely. It's an icebreaker. And something I've left out from the whole context, and forgive me because I'm so used to talking on sales podcasts where a lot of stuff is fully taken for granted, and I recognize this is a very different kind of podcast.
Sure.
Is that, executives and managers at companies, they're swamped with cold emails from vendors, cold calls. They're getting texts, believe it or not, from companies they've never heard of, from people they never heard of, the companies they've never heard of. They're getting video messages, social media. Sellers are trying to slide into their direct messages. So buyers or prospects are just being like overwhelmed. And so much of the messaging is very vanilla. And I'm trying to help a lot of sales reps add, A, understand is vanilla the flavor that they want? And if it is, great, but then put some chocolate sauce, some brownie bits, some score bits on top. You can add in whatever flavor you like. That's entirely up to you. But exactly, how do we figure out what flavors what's gonna help a buyer want to take that inbound message and engage in a discussion?
Can you talk, just to take a step back, can you talk a little bit about how you discovered stand-up and kind of what your pathway into that specific realm was?
Yeah, I guess I was always a guy who liked art. And when I say art, I love music. I always loved comedy. I loved creative writing. And I was someone who was, let's just say, discouraged heavily from ever pursuing anything even remotely frivolous from a career perspective. So I just, you know, went along, got a couple of business degrees, got into sales by accident. And sales is, you know, there's a science of sales, but it can also be an art. How you connect with a buyer can be an art form that if it works for you, great. It might not work for someone else. And so I was humming along in my sales career, but I always needed that creative outlet. I would organize little music groups and I'd slowly get nudged out because I was always the weakest link. I'm a good organizer and I was good at putting the right people together, but I kind of want to be walking fast and they wanted to jog or even sprint a little bit and I couldn't keep up. And eventually that ran its course. I took an improv class, which I had done in the past. And there was too many people in the class who didn't realize that improv is a team sport. And at that point, I heard about a comedy writing class. And I said, you know what? Even though I'm sort of tired of working with people, I still want to find someone who's on the same page as me to create some sketches, maybe some YouTube videos. And I thought that would be really cool. But I landed in the class. And the teacher, who's a local stand-up comedian, said, after 10 weeks of this class, you're going to do 5 minutes of stand-up comedy for your friends and family. And I said, this is a stand-up class. I'm not doing that. That's not why I'm here. I just want to meet some writing buddies. And he would give us little exercises and every week I'd get on stage. And early on, it felt like, in a sense, not too dissimilar from making a corporate presentation to a boardroom where a bunch of old white men, their arms are folded and they're like, who's this kid? It felt very similar. And I realized the only thing I need to do is I don't have to sell them some ridiculous technology. I have to just get them to open up, unfold their arms to my ideas and be receptive and lean in. And I would get them to do that. And it's a very addictive process. And so after about 6 or 7 weeks, I said, yeah, I'll do the final exam. And I did my 5 minutes in front of strangers. I did not invite a single friend or family member. That's the one part I chose to totally ignore. I'm not doing this in front of anyone I know. And I made them laugh and I was addicted. I'm like, I want to do that again. And I did it again and I got more laughs. And then the third time on stage, it was mainly in front of comics and I bombed so hard. I blanked. I got heckled by another comic who was on psychedelic drugs. He had said it on stage and he was like right before me and he was like, I'm on mushrooms. And he was heckling me from the back of the room and I blanked and I bombed more and I was up there for 10 minutes and I was only supposed to be up there for 5. But I also said, I'm not walking off stage, because I don't remember my stuff. I'm going to get through this. And at that point, a whole new cycle within me started, which is like, I don't want this to be the last time I do comedy. I want to try and not let that happen again. So when I said earlier, I want to get off the stage without embarrassing myself, that's exactly what I was referring to.
It's funny that you made the conscious decision not to invite friends or family, because I wonder if that's the sort of thing where if it's an active thought of being like, I don't want to embarrass myself in front of people I know, or if there's, I don't want to have that false encouragement of them laughing because they think they're supposed to.
Well, what was interesting about that audience was it was a very supportive crowd because they were everyone else's friends and family. But the fact that I was making strangers laugh made me feel good. Exactly what you said. I did not want false encouragement from anybody. I wanted to know, am I making strangers laugh? Yes or no.
So it gives you a real barometer as to like how what your skill was at that level.
Which was pretty poor. Yes.
You said something earlier about sales being an art to a certain degree or that it can be an art. And I would agree with that. I'm wondering from your perspective, what do you think is like the sales gene? Because from where I'm sitting, I would imagine that there are some people that can do that job and there are some people that absolutely cannot do that job. What do you think it takes to kind of, what makes you cut out to be a good salesperson?
I think a lot of people have a lot of preconceived notions of who and what salespeople are. I'm not talking about, you know, zero base salary with 100% commission kind of sales who are just on the hustle. I'm talking about consultative sellers, people who work, who have a base salary. And there's a commission aspect to it, but they succeed when they help their customers solve problems, especially in the world of technology. Like that's the world I know. I can't speak to insurance salespeople very well, but even industrial supplies, pharmaceutical companies. Like every industry has a different kind of dynamic, but I can speak to technology sales. And you know, there's the companies we do business deal with hundreds and hundreds of technology vendors themselves, and I think there's a curiosity that's necessary. There's a desire to serve and to help their clients and to help them succeed, because sales that kind of sales, win-win outcomes are really how you succeed. If your customer's succeeding, you will succeed. And so it can't be just about, I want to get them to sign a purchase order to me so I can invoice them and collect a commission. It has to be like, how can I develop a relationship with these people over time so that we can help each other? And I'm just trying to think like what else I can add to that. Just this desire to want to interact with people, because you can't help them if you don't want to interact with them in the first place. And those, I think, are from my perspective, the things that have helped me succeed in sales, is forming good connections with some people, understanding what are your challenges. Can I help you? No, I'm going to go away. Maybe I can help you in the future. Can I help you? Yes, let's try and figure out a solution at a price point that makes sense. And if it doesn't make sense, that's okay too.
To set the stage, can you talk a little bit about what some of the challenges were that you were facing with your business in a normal year, in a pre-COVID society?
Sure. Where do we begin? And how long is this podcast going to be? The whole idea of comedy writing for sales teams has been admittedly very confusing for many. Some people think I'm a stand-up comedian who tells sales jokes to their team. Others think that I'm going to teach their sellers to tell Don Rickles and Howard Stern type jokes to their buyers, offend them, and the company goes out of business because they've been served with a lawsuit. And it's none of these things. And there's no simple way to package up exactly what it is I do with sales teams. There's no one brand. There's no one, you know, catch-all brand name that I can give to myself to help simplify and explain exactly what I do. And I'm also in a market, Montreal, which doesn't have a strong sales culture. A lot of American cities have loads of sales meetups every quarter for sales professionals. There's several groups out there that if you were to visit any major US city, you can go to a networking and learning event and score your next job, score new clients, learn, grow. We don't really have that culture here in Montreal for a variety of reasons. So I was starting this new idea that no one's ever heard of or done on a literal and figurative island. And so it was always a challenge, and I'm not a digital marketing expert. I had come off another project in the world of comedy, which was also a little bit out of the box, that didn't go in the direction I wanted to for a million reasons. And I learned stuff from that. But, you know, I kind of came at this at a point where I don't have deep financial reserves. So I need to figure out how to make this work. And I've had a lot of learnings along the way, and I've grown. But there were a lot of challenges with getting on radars of the right people. When I first started, I thought, well, everyone's going to need me for a sales meeting. I'm fun. I'm team building. I'm unique. There's learning. People need a break from boring sales trainings. But it's great that I thought that, but now I had to educate the whole world on all that stuff and that value. So there were lots of challenges and confusion around what I do and my value. That was kind of like challenge number one. Challenge number two was, okay, well, if I like what John does, where do I bring him in? Well, we have quarterly sales meetings. How much time do you need, John? I think 4 hours of your meeting would be good for me, because that way we can accomplish quite a bit. We don't have 4 hours to give you. And we only think it's good to do it when everyone's here. And so I would lose opportunities like that if once I found them. So it was really like there were a lot of moving parts to getting booked for gigs. But I was doing it. I was sustaining myself. And then the pandemic comes along where there's no more on-site meetings, no more on-site events. And that was obviously a blow to the pipeline, as we say in the sales business.
So what was your initial reaction when the pandemic first hit? How were you anticipating that it was going to impact your business directly or indirectly?
Well, just in reaching out to my prospects, everyone's like, yeah, we have to put our event that we were considering you for on hold. We don't know when this is going to happen. And I was like, okay, I got to figure something out because I'm not getting booked anytime soon. And I had had a remote offer for what I do because some were suggesting I have it. But whenever I position it, they would say, well, we think this would be better if you were here. I'm like, okay, that's great. It's more money. I'll take that. But you know, if the events aren't happening, then I need to figure out how to make this remote thing work. And so two things happened. I live and breathe on LinkedIn. Find me on LinkedIn, John Seelig. And when the pandemic hit, there's a world that probably none of your listeners know about. There's just this whole world of sales influencers and sales personalities and sales trainers and coaches and thought leaders, like on LinkedIn. My whole feed is just sales, 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 sales. It's pretty sickening, actually. However, everyone and their mother and their father was on LinkedIn with very cliche advice like, it's a pandemic. Don't call your customer and say, are you ready to buy? We need to show them empathy. And I thought this was really elementary advice. Since when do you not need to use empathy in sales? It's very important. And I was just like, okay, I don't feel like trying to fight this battle right now. I'm going to figure out how can I get on some radars in a different way. If you've ever read Linchpin by Seth Godin, or I haven't read it, but The Purple Cow, I think preaches something different. How can you stand out and be different from everybody and sort of use what you have to move in different directions? If everyone's swimming upstream, how do you move downstream? And I realized, okay, well, what makes me different from every sales trainer and coach and thought leader? It's the fact that I do stand up and I can make people laugh. And to get on radars, I'm like, okay, I need some good PR right now. I'm out of content ideas. I'm burnt out for a lot of reasons. I just started to do fundraiser stand-up for sales teams. I said, hey, book me. I'm on a quest to raise $25,000. I created a funny video. Book me for your sales team. Don't pay me a dime. Give $500, give $1,000 to a nonprofit that's helping those impacted by COVID. And all I asked in return was to make a post about me on LinkedIn and that I'm doing this and trying to raise $25,000. And what that did was it got me in a lot of people's LinkedIn feeds, and I was creating some other content, and I was generating some interest in myself and some noise around myself, and to the point where companies started to reach out to me. They were checking out my LinkedIn profile, which would take them to my webpage. I started to get some requests for, we're looking at a workshop. Can we talk? So it generated enough interest in me and the fact that I'm different than everyone else. And it helped me establish my credibility as someone who can make people laugh. And that's kind of how I kickstarted the remote offering while I was doing the stand-up. I was building out my remote offering in such a way that I could deliver it over multiple sessions over time to sales teams in bite-sized approaches so they could learn over time versus you got to learn everything in 4 hours when I'm on site and we're all together.
I think everybody tends to be very sensitive and measured when it comes to talking about COVID in any type of positive way, just because of how horrific it's been for so many people. But I do think that there's something to be said for businesses that have been given some type of advantage, and not in a way that is necessarily profiting off of this, but has forced them to redirect or kind of develop a different type of experience for their businesses, for their clients. Can you talk a little bit about what your virtual offering kind of was pre the pandemic, and then what maybe it changed or evolved into, and if there was an advantage that was gained by people having to change the way that they meet for sales discussions?
Yeah. I mean, I sort of offered remote to clients if they didn't need me for a meeting, but they were looking for messaging. I had this approach, well, give me five of your people and I'll work with them to craft some messaging that the rest of your sales team can use to start new conversations with buyers, to be memorable. Because if I tell you a funny joke and you remember, you go tell it to a friend, it goes viral, right? And I think that salespeople can have that same approach with jokes just for their buyers. Jokes that demonstrate that subject matter expertise in a way that no one else can. The jokes won't make sense to anyone but to their buyers. And if, in case I haven't been clear, that's exactly what comes out of my workshop. When the pandemic hit, I realized a few things. There aren't going to be meetings. And a major reason why companies looked at me for meetings is they said, well, our whole team will be here on that date. When we're having a sales meeting, everyone's here. And once we're paying for you, we want you to help everybody. But the reality is maybe I don't need to help everybody. Maybe I need to help 25% of their team. Or maybe if they have a team of 100 people and they're segmented into sales development, closers, customer success, pre-sales people, which is typical at tech companies, maybe I just work with one of those teams. It just made me realize I can work. I'm not limited by time or by numbers anymore. And we're not constrained by this whole notion of we're having a sales meeting. In other words, do you want your people to develop and grow their skills from a written and oral perspective? Do you want them to become better communicators? Do you want them to better relate to your buyers? Well, they're not going to do it all in 4 hours in a sit-down workshop on site. But let's do it over time and let's give them things to think about. Some of the best creativity comes to us in the shower, on a walk. Let's let them mull things over in between sessions if they so choose to. They might not. But there's always a few people in my workshops who really love what I do. And they're the ones who kind of like drag their breakout group over the goal line. They're like, I got this for us. And they're just kind of helping that person with some extra insight or creativity. But they have like some big idea that gets their group over the goal line and assembling jokes that as I call it, roast their prospect's pain. So the pandemic just made me like, made my head explode when this all started. I mean, I'm still building out offerings that are different price points for different team sizes over different time spans.
Being that stand-up comedy is such a it's so intrinsically, I think, important for it to be something that is happening live, that's happening with a group of people in the same space. Did you anticipate that there would be something lost in the way that you do business by losing the live events, or did you anticipate that there would be something gained by being able to, like what you've described, break out that 4-hour session into a more segmented type of offering?
I anticipated something would be gained and that ultimately it could be more valuable for them because, you know, we use Zoom breakout rooms to sort of, you know, put the different breakout groups in, so to speak, a different Zoom room. I really didn't have that much in the way of preconceived notions of how everything was going to unfold. I just knew I had to do it or else, you know, I die professionally. The business goes away if I don't adapt. Like, necessity is the mother of all invention. I didn't really have preconceived notions. Is this going to work? Is this not? I just had to do it. I didn't see why it wouldn't work. I shouldn't say that because there still was some confusion around what I do. But I knew that I also started to see how to remarket myself and reposition what I do. That a lot of things were converging together for me. I'd been around the right amount of time that enough people recognized me from LinkedIn. A lot of the pandemic happened at a really weird time for me. If I would have just been starting out, I wouldn't have made it through the pandemic.
Yeah, I would imagine that you would have to have a level of experience or reputation to fall back on to be able to kind of pivot in the. I mean, it feels like everybody needed to make a snap decision and find some way to change their business model. And I would imagine that anybody who was at the beginning of their journey was going to have a much more difficult time, especially where you had already had a digital offering or a virtual offering. It seems like you kind of had laid the groundwork to then grow it to a certain degree.
Well, it just had to replace a live one and it had to be broken apart and rebuilt and remarketed. And so I started to map out, well, like what's the offer? How many hours is it? What do they need to do before the class? What will they do after the class? And I just started to see it coming together over you know, a 2 month period. I started to just smash it all apart and map it out on paper and figure out what can I offer this sales team or what can I offer that kind of sales team? Cause they come in all different shapes and sizes and objectives. They all have different objectives. So it was some work and some sweat, but I did it eventually. And I think even beyond the pandemic, even if they want me live for, let's say, a keynote session, that can be used to kick off a workshop for, let's say, a third of the people who want to go through it.
Are you looking forward to when you can get back to the ability to do in-person live, maybe 3 or 4 hour workshops? Or are you thinking that the more sustainable future for your business is maybe to lean more heavily into what you're doing now in terms of the virtual offering?
It's an amazing question. I'm not sure because I love being live. I love being in person. I love flicking, seeing the switches in their brains get flicked on when I give them a piece of advice or insight or instruction. I love seeing that light bulb go off live. I love running around and sometimes they don't get what we're doing. We take a series of steps to kind of build their inventory of expressions and phrases and knowledge. And they're like, why are we doing this? We don't get this. And by the time the session's over, they're on stage telling jokes and they get it. And so I kind of miss seeing it all come together in an afternoon. That said, I don't think it's the most effective form of training. It's also, it's a pain to travel. I loved it for a while, but I was on the road a lot last year. The year before last year, because this past year, I've just been in this apartment. And I didn't realize that it was taxing. I sort of like the pandemic was sort of nice because I didn't have to like worry about getting to the airport and getting on the flight. And as a Canadian, you know, going through customs, because a lot of my clients are in the US. So some stress was removed. When this is over, I would go back, to in person at least part of the time, like maybe again to kick off a workshop, maybe to close off a workshop. There's all kinds of new and exciting possibilities once the pandemic is over on how to blend on-site and remote training and workshops. So I'm not sure yet. I also need to figure out what the economics look like because there is time involved with travel and energy sapped and it distracts you from other things. I kind of like doing even a keynote session and I'm done and I could just go make coffee in my own kitchen and eat Oreos out of a bag. You know, I love that.
What do you anticipate from the perspective of maybe some of these organizations or some of these sales teams? Do you think that they are going to want to get back to a place of being live and in person and together? Or has this kind of new paradigm that we've moved into, is this going to make people feel like, well, we can do the job this way remotely. We can Zoom with each other. We've found a way to make it work. Maybe there's more of a remote workflow moving forward versus everyone being kind of at an office or at a place of business.
Yeah. I mean, I think every company is going to have to answer that question for themselves because companies are comprised of people. People are either competent or not. And at both the worker and managerial level, and some are secure and some are not. And I think the companies that stay remote are going to have secure employees who are competent and know what they're doing. And there's a trust involved. Everyone does their part remotely. That'll work. Maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm a chief executive officer and I don't really have confidence in my team and my ability and their abilities. Why? Because maybe they don't have confidence in their own abilities and maybe they want everyone back on site. But we're going to see more and more companies moving fully remote, especially in the tech space. I kind of think they're going to be gathering once a quarter in a certain spot and they'll invest in travel versus commercial real estate. I don't fully know the answer, but I think there'll be some hybrid stuff. Like if we look at Salesforce, I think there's some people who think Mark Benioff said, if you want to be remote, but there's a certain type of employee that still needs to come into an office. Not sure exactly. He's the CEO of Salesforce. I'm not sure who he's referring to. But every company is going to have to look at this and assess based on who their people are, what's the best way for us to move forward?
Specifically, your stand-up comedy aspect of your life, what do you think the overall effect is going to be on stand-up comedy in general now that COVID has, you know, kind of reared its head?
Yeah. So I was at a weird place with stand-up. Again, I wasn't trying to become a stand-up comedian, but it was sort of like the way some people do CrossFit. They would try and build up their bodies. I try and destroy mine through stand-up comedy and going out 2, 3, 4 nights a week and just getting on stages and, you know, socializing with some weird people and not just the comedians. Sometimes the people in the audience can be pretty weird. Some of them are really great. But I've had a weird relationship with it the last couple of years as I've been invested more time into this business. Because at the end of the day, stand-up doesn't pay any bills and it sucks your energy. Like that's a reality. If you want to go do stand-up with any level of impact, you have to write, you have to practice, you have to iterate, you have to talk to yourself in your apartment, you have to travel to the venue, you have to wait around while the other comedians are going on, you have to deal with other comedians and other rigmarole, and then you get up there for 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, tell your jokes. And then you get off and it's weird. It's a weird little thing. You invest a lot of time. And most of the time, you're not getting any money. So I kind of had to take my foot off the gas from a comedy perspective, live and in person. But it doesn't mean I don't think about comedy, because I do love it. And I love figuring out how to push people's buttons. But in my 10 years of comedy, I produced a show for 6 years. I've been in touch with comedians from all over North America and even outside North America who would pass through Montreal and would do my show. And you know, we're all connected on Facebook. I keep on top of their careers. And some of them who are good, like you know, let's face it, it's really hard to go up in front of an audience of strangers and make them laugh. And there's a lot of people, there's not many people on the planet who can do it, but there is a good number of them. There's a number of them who can do it more than we realize, but only a fraction of those people make a living at it. And so those people who weren't making really a living at it and were good, those people I see questioning their future in comedy because they needed to go earn during the pandemic. Like they couldn't just like set up a Zoom show and get everyone to pay $10 and get 75 people there once a week, which for some comedians, like that's all they need is maybe they need 750, 1,000 a week to survive. But I've seen a lot of talented people who I think are questioning their relationship with comedy because when comedy comes back, everyone's going to want to go see the big acts. They won't necessarily want to go to the lower shows where some of these people were working on. It's had all these ripple effects. And the question is, will clubs even be allowed to go to capacity once we're all vaccinated? So there will be less spots for people. There's going to be less crowds. There's going to be less money. And I think that's going to impact stand-up comedy for quite some time. And I think there's also people who are new at it who might not get spots at all, even if like there's just going to be such a demand for stage time at all levels of comedy that some people will get squeezed out and get frustrated and walk away from it. I can admit, as much as I kind of want to go do it again, I'm sort of not in a rush.
In the very general sense of a small business owner from that perspective, what do you think people need to be aware of when it comes to small businesses now in 2021?
They need to be aware of everything, that there's so much more to being a small business owner than just the product or service that you're offering. There's the back end, there's the marketing side, which is, that is a beast, especially if you're a work from home solopreneur like me. That is by far the hardest piece of the puzzle to solve, is where do I put my dollars and my energy from a digital marketing perspective to hone in on my target market, make them aware of what I have to offer and how it's going to benefit them. That's a beast of an effort. And that's an ongoing process, which I'm still trying to sort out. And there's the administrative side. There's so many new ways to do things today, especially if you're, you know, I think if you're a Gen Z entrepreneur, you could be familiar with all these tools out there and ways of doing things. But I sort of was away from a professional environment for a few years, and when I started, I was doing things the way I knew how to do them 10 years ago. And that's not effective today. But I've learned a lot over that time. And we just have to be prepared to keep learning, keep speaking to people who are ahead of us in the game, regardless of their age. I learn a lot from people who are much younger than me. And I learn a lot from people who are older than me still. And I just think that you need to be aware of going into business for yourself is not just about doing what you love. It's about doing a lot of stuff you're not good at and that you're not going to like. Until you can get to this point where you're making enough money, where you can hire people to do all that stuff, and you can focus on the things you're good at and love. And that's the thing that everyone needs to be mindful of.
Let me just kind of reframe that question from the perspective of a consumer. What do you want consumers to be aware of when it comes to small businesses in 2021?
I don't know about consumers, but I do know in my world, I'll be speaking with some middle management or even senior executives within a sales organization at a large company. And they'll have two or three or four calls to me about what I do. And they tell me they'll get back to me. Don't worry. By the certain date, and they ghost me, and I'll follow up with them, and they continue to ghost me. And I'm like, look, you could tell me no. I don't care. I'm not a fit. You don't need me now. That's great. But don't ghost me. You know, you see that I don't have a base salary. You see I'm investing time with you, and you're telling me to my face that you really like what I do, and we should be able to do something together. But I guess they're a little embarrassed sometimes when they can't get it done or they can't sell me internally. So I don't know if it's consumers I have the message for, but I guess either way, have empathy for business owners, because especially if they're serving you well, you don't owe them your business. But it's also healthy to be able to say, I can't buy, or I don't think it's the right time. Here's why. Because if you value the service they've given you, you should want them to succeed, and they need your feedback to understand what do they need to adjust so they can succeed in the future with other clients. I get it. You're busy and maybe you don't have good news for me, but I'd rather hear the bad news and the why versus no news at all.
Thank you for listening to Maintaining Sweat Equity. New episodes are available on the 1st and 15th of each month. Please be sure to subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, as well as our video version on YouTube. If you have a story to tell about your small business, email us at maintainingsweatequity@gmail.com. See you in the next episode.